Hello, my dear students. Today we shall look into the topic of the Prime Minister Office, the structure, composition, and its functions. As far as the Prime Minister Office of India is concerned, it consists of the immediate staff of the Prime Minister of India as well as the multiple levels of supporting staff reporting to the Prime Minister. Generally speaking, the PMO is headed by the Principal Secretary. And it is part of the Government of India, located in the southern block of the Secretariat Building, New Delhi. Prime Minister Office, in short form called as PMO, is a staffing agency which assists the Prime Minister in the efficient discharge of his or her role, functions and responsibilities. So it is quite interesting to look into the evolution of the PMO Office. The Prime Minister's Secretariat was created when we attained the Indian independence in 1947. It was originally called the Prime Minister's Secretariat until 1977, when it was renamed during the Morarji Desai ministry. The Secretariat was created for the immediate purpose of taking over the functions performed till then by the Secretary to the Governor General. As the Prime Minister took over almost all functions which the Governor General prior to independence performed as the executive head of the government. Prime Minister Office is an extra constitutional body that has no mention in the Indian Constitution. However, it was given the status of a department under the Government of India Allocation of Business Rules 1961. Since June 1977, it is known as Prime Minister's Office and is headed by the Secretary to the Prime Minister, who is now designated as the Principal Secretary to the Prime Minister. So we have seen all the Central Secretariat, Cabinet Secretariat, State Secretariat and other things. Then why the PMO office is needed? It is because the complexity and scope of government have increased tremendously during these years. So it requires a strong and technically efficient staff agency to handle the same. And the problems of coordination between the ministers are becoming more complex in this competitive world. And since all ministers are entitled to have an office set up of their own to enable them to perform their functions, similarly, on the same ground, the PMO is the office of the Prime Minister. Most importantly, the PMO has two irreducible functions. The first one being the PMO is a conduit to and from the Prime Minister. Secondly, the Prime Minister depends on PMO, that is, the Principal Secretary to the Prime Minister, if he wants a second opinion on any matter. Hope you'd have understand why the PMO office is required as far as India is concerned. So here you see the list of our Prime Ministers of India so far and the present Prime Minister. So coming into the evolutionary trend from various Prime Ministers, the degree of centralization of Indian administration has been influenced by the nature of Prime Minister and the influencing position of his or her secretary. And it is being illustrated as follows. A. Jain had to provide procedural assistance to the Prime Minister. At that time, he was not think tank of Prime Minister. That was the position of the secretary during Jawaharlal Nehru's time. During Lal Bahadur Shastri ministry, L.K. Jha concentrated more powers on economic affairs. And again, during the period of Mrs. Indira Gandhi, L.K. Jha got strengthened in terms of political as well as economic affairs. And it was at this time, Prime Minister's office was assumed as a super cabinet of Indian administration. Again, during the period of Indira Gandhi, P.N. Haskar became so influenced that it acted as micro cabinet of Indian administration, and the most popular program of Indira Gandhi, Garibi Hatao program, was drafted without consultation with other cabinet ministers by the PMO office itself. At this time, the influential position of the Prime Minister's office was stronger than the cabinet secretariat. PMS represents Prime Minister's secretariat down here. And again, during the period of Indira Gandhi, P.N. Dhar, in this period, the stability in composition was maintained. So, we can understand that during the period of Indira Gandhi, the Prime Minister office was so strong in its nature and it was carrying out its functions in a very efficient manner as well. Next comes the period of Morarji Desai. Only during this time, Prime Minister's Secretariat was renamed as Prime Minister's Office. At this time, the powers and influences of PMO was undermined to make the Cabinet Secretary strong. During the second term of Indira Gandhi, P.C. Alexander was the secretary of the PMO and it got strengthened by putting the necessary infrastructure. Thus, it became stronger than the Cabinet Secretary. Rajiv Gandhi followed Indira Gandhi as the Prime Minister of India, and during his period as well, P.C. Alexander was holding the PMO office secretarial position and got so full-fledged administrative infrastructure with 3 additional secretaries, 5 joint secretaries, and it got the status of the department under the allocation of business rules. Again, during the period of Rajiv Gandhi, Sarla Grewal was a PMO office secretary and she maintained stability in office. B.J. Deshmukh was another secretary of PMO office during the period of Rajiv Gandhi, and the PMO office got the apex level of centralization in terms of government functions. Coming to the period of Narasimha Rao, A.N. Verma was a political executive attached to the PMO, and the centralization was maintained in order to cope up with the problems arising from the coalition government. Thus, the trend is getting changed in the office of the Prime Minister during the different prime ministership of different people. Coming to the period of Atal Bihari Vajpayee, Brijesh Mishra was the secretary of the PMO office and it got further strengthened to cope with the rising functional demands of the prime ministerial democracy, and its role was extended to many parallel organizations. And coming back to the Manmohan Singh government, A. Nair was the secretary of the PMO office and it was made a separate institution in functional terms. Its responsibility was separated from security aspects according to K. Subramaniam committee recommendation. And at present, during the prime ministership of Narendra Modi, N. Mishra is the secretary of the PMO office, and thus the degree and status and influence of the PMO office has been a reflection of personal nature of Prime Minister and the responsive nature of politico-administrative situation. So this is absolutely the information you should know regarding the trends in the evolutionary aspects of the PMO office so far. Coming into the important part of the PMO office, which means the structure of the Prime Minister's office. As you all know that it is politically headed by the Prime Minister and administratively headed by the Principal Secretary, followed by 1 or 2 additional secretaries, 5 joint secretaries, a number of directors, deputy secretaries and undersecretaries, and finally the personnel or generally drawn from the civil services and also appointed for the varying periods. Now we are looking here the structure of Prime Minister's office, which is being represented in a flowchart. Prime Minister followed by the Cabinet of the Prime Minister, the Head of Prime Minister's Office, Ministers without the portfolio, followed by the Government Communication Unit, Administrative State Secretary, Political State Secretary, Mirror Ministry, Strategical Analyzing Unit as well. So what do the Prime Minister Office do? The administrative functions of the Prime Minister Office is concerned. It acts as a link between the Prime Minister and his ministers, President, Governors, Chief Ministers and also foreign representatives. And on the other side, that is the public side, where it is concerned with the party matters, personal correspondences, complaints from the public and many more. The Prime Minister Office also helps the Prime Minister in the performance of his functions as the head of the government. So far we have seen the structure and the administrative functions. Now comes the principal functions of the Prime Minister Office. It deals with all references which are under the rules of business have come to the Prime Minister. The Prime Minister Office helped the Prime Minister in the discharge of his overall responsibilities as the Chief Executive, like liaison with the Union Ministries and the State Governments on matters which the Prime Minister may be interested. It also helps the Prime Minister in the discharge of his responsibilities as the Chairman of the Planning Commission. It deals with the public relations side of the PMO Office to provide the Prime Ministerial assistance in the examination of cases submitted to him for an order under prescribed rules. So the next one is the status of the PMO. The personality of the Principal Secretary and his relationship with the Prime Minister determines the status of the PMO. The Prime Minister's trust in the Principal Secretary determines the position of PMO. Further, the status of the Prime Minister within the Cabinet is also a determining factor. If he is weak, he will have to take all decisions in the cabinet. In this case, the PMO will be weak and vice versa. If it is a coalition government, naturally the allies would have to be involved in the decision-making process. In a coalition government, the status of PMO may be less powerful when compared to a prime minister who is the leader of the majority party. So you can understand strength of the PMO when there is a majority government and when there is a coalition government. While the decentralization causes chaos, centralization too comes at a cost. The Prime Minister must pay close attention to how they manage their tendencies to centralize. They must tread that fine path on which they maintain control over their administrations and organizations. And during the recent years, there is an emerging negative trend in the working of the PMO. It is being said that PMO has become an overgrown, overarching, all-powerful organization, which is a grave threat to the parliamentary democracy and hence subverts the constitution. These allegations have been because of the following factors. Most of the prime ministers have regarded the PMO as a parallel government. Whichever party in power and whosoever has filled the post of the prime minister, it has been observed that there has been a growing tendency towards centralization in decision making. Not only does a prime minister sometimes keep with himself an unduly large number of portfolios, but also informally exerts his real influence beyond those formally held portfolios. Thus, it intrudes into the domain of individual ministries. The next one is, if the prime minister is politically unchallenged in his party, his control over other ministries and departments through the mechanism of monitoring becomes very high. Instead of remaining within its envisaged role of providing secretarial assistance to the Prime Minister in the discharge of his functions, the PMO increasingly has to say in the policy formulation. And finally, the reshuffling of the cabinet has taken place many times based on the advice of the PMO. Hope you'd have understood the structure, functions, the evolutionary trend and the negative trend in the emerging scenario of the PMO office. Thank you very much for watching, and I will see you all in the next video with another important topic.